A very good morning to all the students. You are listening to the lecture series of the course Power Quality provided by DTU eShikshana. I am Dr. Prema, Associate Professor in BMS College of Engineering, Bangalore. So in the last few lectures, we were discussing the third module of the course Power Quality, and the third module was on the fundamentals of harmonics. So in the third module, we discussed the definition of fundamentals of harmonics, what is a harmonic, and then we discussed the differences between current harmonic and voltage harmonic. We also discussed the difference between a harmonic and a transient, and we saw how a harmonics are produced in the power system. We saw that it is mainly because of the nonlinear loads present in the system and their interaction with the system impedance. We also saw the harmonic indices, the terminologies which are used to evaluate harmonics. They are the THD and TDD, total harmonic distortion and total demand distortion. And we also saw the various harmonic sources in commercial and industrial loads. We also saw the effects of harmonics on various power system parameters. So today we will start with the module 4, which is a continuation of the module 3, and the module 4 is applied harmonics. So in this module, we are going to discuss about the harmonic evaluation of the harmonic distortion. So when we talk about the evaluation of the harmonic distortion, we have to see the evaluation from the utility side and the end user side. So we will see what are the evaluation techniques which can be used in the utility side and in the end user side. Then we will see the control of harmonic. How can the harmonics be controlled? There are mainly three ways by which we can control the harmonics. One is by reducing the harmonic currents in the load. And then the second method is filtering. And third method is by changing the frequency response itself. That means by modifying the frequency response. And the next topic which we'll be covering in this module is where to control the harmonics. Where exactly we need to have this controlling techniques applied, whether it is in the utility side or the end user side. If it is in the utility side, how do we do that? And if it is for the end user side, how do we do that? So this is what we'll be seeing. And the next topic is, what are the procedures followed for studying the harmonics in the system? So we have the procedure for harmonic studies, and we will also study how we are going to model the harmonic sources and how we are going to model the system to study harmonics. And in this topic, we will also see what are the computer techniques which are used for studying the harmonics. And then we will see some of the devices to control harmonics. So in that, we will see what are the reactors or chokes, and then we will see what's the zigzag transformer, and we will also see passive and active filters. So these are the various devices to control harmonics. And then we will see the filter design. We will see some case studies of some filters, and we will see how the designing is done and what are the calculations involved in the filter design technique. And then lastly, we will see the standards on harmonic. The standards are very important in harmonic because there are a lot of limitations which are kept by the government, and the standards decided by IEEE that has to be followed when you are in the power system. So we need to study the details of the standards also. So this is what we are going to cover in this unit. This may take 6 to 7 lectures. So we are in the first lecture of module 4. So we'll start with the first topic, that is harmonic distortion evaluation. Now, when we talk of harmonic currents, we know, we have seen from the module 3 that harmonic currents are mainly produced by nonlinear loads. And these harmonic currents can interact adversely with the utility system, and it can cause a lot of harm in the system. Now, this interaction of the utility with the nonlinear loads will produce voltage harmonics and current harmonics, which can be observed in different places in the system in different forms. Thus, to limit these distortions, to limit both voltage and current distortion, the IEEE standards have proposed some limitations for the injection of harmonic currents and the for the reduction of harmonic voltages. So, and this approach requires participation from both end users and the utility, because the harmonic distortion is mainly because of the harmonic injection of the nonlinear load from the end users, which produces voltage distortion in the system. So because of that, the approach requires participation from both end user side and the utility. Now, if you talk of individual end users, IEEE standard, the standard is 519-1992 limits the level of harmonic injection at the point of common coupling. So if you are talking about the end users, IEEE standard limits the level of harmonic current injection. But if you talk of the utility is mainly responsible for the voltage distortion. And why we are talking about current, harmonic current in the individual end users? Because individual end users have the control over the harmonic injection of the harmonic current. In a similar way, the utility is responsible for limiting the harmonic distortion at the point of common coupling. We'll discuss about point of common coupling in the next slide. So here limits are given for for injection of harmonic current by the end users and the limit voltage distortion at the utility side. And we will see what are these standards and what are the limits of this voltage distortion and current injection. We'll see that. But here we are just discussing that the end users are responsible for the current harmonic. So there is a limit for the end users to inject the harmonic current in the system. Similarly, the utility will be responsible to limit the voltage distortion in the system. And there are standard values which are given by IEEE to limit these values. So we are going to see in detail of these. This is called basically harmonic evaluation. Now the limits are given for individual harmonic distortion and total harmonic distortion. So in the last unit, we have seen how we have to calculate the individual harmonic distortion and how the total harmonic distortion in the system has to be evaluated. So we'll have to evaluate that and we'll have to see that these values are within the limits prescribed by the IEEE standard. And so now let us see. So here we have seen the word point of common coupling, right, many times. So everything, all these limits are depending upon the point of common coupling. So let us have a little bit of light on what is this point of common coupling. And generally, all the harmonic evaluations or the evaluations of the harmonic distortions are generally performed at the point between the end user or the customer and the utility system where more than one customer can be added. So there will be one point where the where the utility system and the customer meets, and where at that point there will be provision to add more customers. So that point is called point of common coupling. This PCC can be located at either primary side of the transformer, service transformer, or the secondary side of the service transformer, depending upon where the end user is. For example, if there are multiple customers which are served from primary of the service transformer, then PCC will be located at the primary. But on the other hand, if the multiple customers are served from the secondary of the transformer, the PCC will be located at the secondary. So basically, PCC is a point where the point of intersection or point between the customer and the end user. And it can be determined by where the multiple customers can be added. Now, this idea will be clearer by the pictures shown here. So this is one example of a point of common coupling. So here we can see that we can see the utility system, we can see the source utility system, and then we can see that on the primary of the transformer, there are multiple customers served. So the primary of the transformer will be the point of common coupling. Now, if you see another figure, here, so you can make out the difference between the first figure and this, right? In the first figure, the primary, the more customers were connected to the primary. But here, multiple customers are connected to the secondary of the service transformer. So here PCC will be at the secondary of the transformer. And also here, when we are discussing this, we should note that the primary of the transformer is the PCC. When the primary, so here in the figure, secondary is the primary. But if you see the previous figure, primary is the PCC. So we have to know that if primary is the PCC, the current measurements for verification can still be performed at the transformer secondary. The measurement results should be referred to the transformer high side by turns ratio of the transformer. So we know how to refer to the primary by secondary or secondary by primary. So accordingly, the calculations need to be done. And the effect of transformer connection on, so we know that the zero sequence current affects the transformer connection depending upon the transformer connection. So also when you're evaluating the PCC, when the current measurements are done on the secondary, we should make sure that the connections are there so that the zero sequence currents are calculated properly. For instance, suppose if you have a delta star connected transformer that will not allow the zero sequence current components to flow from the secondary to the primary system because we have a delta star transformer. Now, these secondary components are trapped in the primary delta winding because we have a delta in the primary and star in the secondary. So the zero sequence current in the primary, because it is a delta connection, it gets trapped in the primary itself. So therefore, but in the star, we have a zero sequence current. So therefore, the zero sequence component measured on the secondary side should not be included in the evaluation of PCC on the primary side, because on the primary side, we have a delta connection where the zero sequence currents are tracked. But when we see the secondary, because it's a star connection, we may get the zero sequence current because when we are doing the measurements in the secondary. But that should not be taken into account when we are seeing the primary current, because in the primary we have a delta connection. So only that has to be taken care. Otherwise, you can do the, even if the PCC in the primary, you can do the current measurement in the secondary, because secondary we will have the easier methods to measure the current. So that has to be taken care. So I hope the concept of PCC is clear to you, where to locate the PCC, and PCC is the point where the evaluations are done. That's why we have this PCC important. Okay, now let us go to the evaluation, how we can do the evaluation. So when we are talking about the harmonic evaluation, as I told, we can do the harmonic evaluation either on the utility side or on the end user side. So let us see how we can do the harmonic evaluations on the utility side and on the end user side. So first, let us take a utility side. So the harmonic evaluations on the utility system involve procedures to determine the acceptability of the voltage distortion for all the customers. So here there is a table given where the THD value is given for different voltage levels. So you can see that the first row is when the voltage is less than 69 kV. And here in this table, the voltage is expressed as a function of a nominal system RMS voltage rather than the fundamental voltage. So it is not the fundamental frequency voltage magnitude given. It is the nominal voltage given. Because we are using this because this allows the evaluation of the voltage distortion with respect to fixed limits rather than the limits of fluctuating the system voltage. So this, as the system voltage fluctuates, the primary voltage also will fluctuate. So that in that way, the definition will not be correct. So we will always take the nominal voltage as a reference when we are talking about the harmonic distortion, when we are evaluating the harmonic distortion. So as per this table, if the nominal voltage is less than or equal to 69 kV, then the maximum individual harmonic voltage distortion can be 3% and the total harmonic distortion can be 5%. It cannot be more than that. Now, if the nominal voltage, this is the bus voltage at the PCC, and if the bus voltage at PCC is within the range of 69 to 161 kV, then the individual harmonic distortion should be lesser than or equal to 1.5%, and the THD can be maximum value of 2.5% only. Now, if the voltage level is more than 161 kV, then further the voltage distortion has to be reduced, or it has to be 1% for the individual harmonic, and for the total harmonic distortion, it has to be maximum of 1.5%. Now, what happens if it is more than this? In case if you are measuring more than a THD, more than these limits, then you will have to do some mitigation techniques so that the voltage distortion limit is less than that. So this is talking about the utility system. That's why we are talking the voltage in the range of kilovolt. So we have three categories here. One is when the voltage is less than 69 kV, then the voltage within the range of 69 to 161 kV, and if the voltage is more than 161 kV. And we have the harmonic distortion ranges also. So the harmonic distortions need to be within this range. This is according to the IEEE standard 519992. So there is, now we have to see how we can actually do the voltage limit evaluation. So we have seen that there is some voltage limit to be followed. The voltage, within that voltage limit, the harmonic distortion level has to be within a particular range. We know that. Now, how exactly do we calculate this voltage limit? That is what we are going to see next. So here, we can see one flow chart. And if you watch this flow chart clearly, what is given here is initially, so basically here we are going to evaluate the voltage limit. So generally the harmonic measurements or the harmonic sources, the characteristics of the harmonic sources on the system are best determined by the existing installation. So we will see whether the installation is an existing one. If we have the existing installations, then these measurements will be performed at the facilities suspected of having offending nonlinear load. If you have very high, if you have existing systems, existing plants, then we will know what are the plants which are causing more nonlinear load. So such systems need to be evaluated. And generally, when you are doing the measurement, you should make sure that you are doing the measurement for at least 1 week, so that all the cyclical load variations can be captured. Because when you are talking about an industrial load, the industry may be working only from Monday to Saturday or Monday to Friday, and you will have a weekend. So weekend, if you take the pattern of weekend or if you take the pattern of a weekday, it will be totally different. So that's why we say that always we should have taken measurement of at least 1 week, so that we will know that cyclic load pattern. And the variations also will depend mainly on the days of operation. And this may be generally periodic with respect to 1 week. So whenever you do any voltage measurement, it has to be at least for 1 week. So in the flowchart, you can see that from the starting, we will see whether it is an existing system or a planned facility, or if it is not a existing system. If it is an existing system, we can directly go with the voltage measurement. And then if it is a non-existing system, or if it's a new or a planned system, then we will have to characterize the harmonic sources. How do we characterize? We will characterize it using the manufacturer's data. We have to characterize and we have to model the system. So there are computer models available. The system response to the harmonic current generally will be determined by developing a computer model to the system. So we will see the frequency response of the system and see whether there are distortions or not. Then we will do the, it is not possible to measure if it is not an existing, if it is just a planned capacity. Right? So in such cases, we will develop a model and then we will observe that model and then we will determine the system. Resonance. We will see whether there is any possibility of resonance because of that nonlinear load with the power delivery system. So we will see the possibility of resonance. This can be generally done by using a frequency scan. And this frequency scans are performed for all the capacitor bank configurations, because we know that this capacitor bank configuration are the main variable that will affect the resonant frequency. So when you have an nonlinear load, we have seen in many case studies in the first lecture, right? The first module, especially in the last lecture, we have seen three different case studies where we saw that even though there are not a single nonlinear load in the system, just because of the presence of a capacitor band and because of the distortion created by some other nonlinear system in some other plant, there is a resonant condition happening with the capacitor bank and the system impedance, right? We have seen that. So because of that, we need to evaluate the frequency, or we need to find out the frequency scan for every capacitor bank. And in the capacitor bank also, we need to do it for every configuration of the capacitor value, so that we have to see all the possibilities of resonant conditions or resonant frequencies. So sometimes what happens, these resonant conditions may not be very critical, because I have seen, I have also discussed that in case if you have a parallel resistance with the capacitance, there is a damping effect and the resonance may not be very highly harmful. So we have to see that those conditions also. And then once we have measured it, and once we have evaluated the distortion level, then what we do, we will see whether these limits are exceeded or not. Now, if it is not exceeded, then it is fine. That means we have not crossed or violated the limits of voltage distortion prescribed by the IEEE standards. Now, if it is exceeding the limit, then what is the next process? We need to evaluate the harmonic control schemes. There are many control schemes available. We are going to see all those control schemes in detail. Okay, so we have to evaluate all the possible control schemes, and we have to fix upon one control scheme where our harmonic distortion will be reduced, and then we have to install that and see that the voltage distortion is within the limit. So this is how we are doing the harmonic evaluation, mainly the voltage limit. So this is for the utility side. Okay, so when we are doing the evaluation for the utility side, what are the steps followed? First step is we have to see whether it is an existing customer, existing plant, or a newly built or a newly planned facility. So if it is existing, then we can directly go with the harmonic voltage measurement. And if you you can do the measurement and see whether it is exceeding the limit or not. Now, if it's a planned capacity, then first we have to characterize the harmonic sources using the manufacturer's data. Once you have done that, we have to create a system model and see the all possibilities. We have to basically create a frequency scan and see whether the possibilities of resonance for every values of the capacitor bank, every possible solutions of the capacitor bank. And then once we have analyzed that, we need to evaluate the distortion level. And after that, we have to see whether the voltage limit is exceeding or not. If it is exceeding, then we have to evaluate the harmonic control scheme. Now, when we talk of harmonic control options, there are many options. They generally consist of harmonic in changing the system frequency response characteristics, or blocking the flow of harmonic current by applying some harmonic filters. So we will be seeing all those in detail, how we can, what are the different types of filters available, and how we can choose which type of harmonic control scheme we want, whether we want a filter or we want to change the frequency response, or we want to modify the load pattern, or we will see all those in detail. So this is the procedure for voltage limit evaluation on the utility side. So next, we will see the harmonic evaluation on the end user side. So when we talk of end user side, here also we have to see, as I told, we have when we talk of end user side, we have to mainly see the limit of harmonic current injection. And we also know that most of the harmonic problems are or at the end user side than the utility system, because we have most of the nonlinear loads at the end user, and this is the main cause of harmonic problem. We also know that highest harmonic voltage distortion levels occur very close to the harmonic sources. So mainly the harmonic sources are loads, right, or the end users. And the most significant problems occur when there are nonlinear loads and there is a power factor correction capacitor. So what happens there when we have nonlinear loads? We will have a harmonic distortion of current, and because of that, we will have many frequencies involved in the voltage. And because of that, if we have a capacitor bank, and that capacitor bank can come in contact with the system impedance, which can form a resonance. And if that resonance frequency matches with any of these frequency components, then we have resonance condition, either series resonance or parallel resonance condition. So because of that, we have to be very careful about the harmonic current injected from the end user. So here in the table, we can see that here also we have three ranges of voltages. If your nominal voltage is less than 69 kV, and if your voltage is within 69 to 161 kV, or if the voltage is more than 161 kV. And here, what are we measuring? We are measuring the short circuit ratio. So here you can see the current. We can see ISC, a parameter ISC, and we can see the parameter IL, and we can also see H, right? So IH is the magnitude of individual harmonic components, generally amplitude, mean amperes in RMS value of the ampere. And then ISC is the short circuit current at the PCC, and IL is the fundamental component of the maximum demand load current at the PCC. So we have to find out the short circuit ratio, which is nothing but ISC by IL. ISC is the short circuit current at the PCC, and IL is the fundamental component of the maximum load demand current at the PCC. Now, what are the limits here? If the short circuit current ratio is less than 20, then we have the limit of harmonics, individual harmonic limits. If it is less than 11, it has to be 4. If it is between 11 and 17, it has to be 2, etc. And the last TDD has to be 5. And why are we measuring TDD instead of THD? In the previous slide, we saw that the voltage limit is by THD, right? But whereas here, at the end user side, we are looking at TDD, because at the utility side, we are looking at the voltage distortion. And generally, voltage distortion is measured by the parameter THD, total harmonic distortion. But when we talk of current distortion, then we have to take the parameter TDD, that is the total demand distortion, right? So we have seen the reason also in the previous lecture. So here we have taken TDD because we are taking the current injection. So when you are talking about the end user, we are limiting the harmonic current injected by the end user. And when we are talking about the utility, we are talking about the voltage distortion created by the utility, right? So here we have the TDD limit for every range of current. If the short circuit ratio is less than 12, or it is between 20 and 50, or 50 to 100, or 100 to 1000, or greater than 1000. And all these ranges are given for different voltage levels. And you can see that as the level increases, as the current ratio increases, the demand TDD should be reduced further. Okay, so these are the limits which are proposed by the IEEE standards. Again, IEEE standard 519-1992. Now, we have to see how we can evaluate this short circuit current. So I told you that all this harmonic evaluation at the end user side depending upon the short circuit current ratio. So now we have to see how we can evaluate the short circuit current. So we have told you that the parameter ISC is the short circuit current at the PCC, and IL is a fundamental component of maximum load current at the PCC. So how do we find out the short circuit current at PCC, which is the parameter ISC? So for computing the short circuit current at PCC, the nominal system conditions that results in minimum short circuit capacity at the PCC need to be evaluated, because that will give you the worst case condition. Now you can obtain this ISC directly from the utility, which will be expressed in amperes, or if it is not available directly in the utility, you can calculate with the formula given here. What is the formula? This is you need to have the MVA rating. What is the MVA rating? It is the short circuit duty in megawatt, megavolt ampere. You need to convert that into amperes by dividing it by the voltage rating. So it is 1000 into MVA upon root 3 kV, because kV and MVA represent the three phase short circuit capacity in mega volt ampere, and kV represents the line to line voltage at the PCC in kilovolt. So if you know the MVA, which is a short circuit capacity of the PCC, that divided by the voltage rating at the PCC will give you the short circuit current at the PCC. So if you know the short circuit current at PCC, you can take it directly. Otherwise, you need to calculate with this formula. And then the next is the parameter IL, which has to be calculated by taking the demand, load demand, right? So you have to calculate the load demand, which can be taken by taking the most recent 12 months kilowatt demand. If you know the kilowatt demand, the current IL can be obtained as that demand divided by the power factor of the system multiplied by the line-to-line voltage of the voltage rating of the system. So with that, we can calculate IL and we can get the ratio of short circuit current to the maximum demand load current. Okay. So this is how we'll be calculating that. Once we calculate this, we'll have to check whether it is within the range of the standard values which are provided by the IEC. If it is not there, then we will have to go for some control technique. Now, there is a, just like how we had a procedure to evaluate the voltage distortion, we have a procedure to evaluate the current limit also. So this is the process by which we will evaluate the current limit. First, we have to define the PCC. So what do you mean by defining the PCC? So for industrial and commercial end users, PCC will be usually at the primary side of the service transformer. So that we have seen what exactly is PCC. Generally, for industrial and commercial users, PCC will be on the primary side of the transformer, which is supplying the facility. So first we have to do that. And then we have to characterize the or calculate the short circuit ratio of at the PCC, that we have seen earlier how we can do that by taking the ratio ISC by IL. And then you have to find out the corresponding limit on the individual and the TDD. So we have to see the limit and we have to see which voltage range we are coming into. Accordingly, looking at the table, we have to see whether what is our limit for the current limit. And then we have to characterize the harmonic sources. Once we have done that, we need to evaluate the harmonic current level with respect to the standards given. And if it is exceeding the limit given by the table, then we have to do the mitigation technique. There are a lot of mitigation techniques available, and then we will have to do that. So here, this is the procedure for evaluating the current. So what I will just have a recap of whatever we have seen today. So we just had an introduction about the harmonic evaluation, how basically we have to do the harmonic evaluation. And we have discussed that if we are talking about the evaluation at the utility side, then we will be taking the voltage distortion into consideration. And if we are taking the evaluations at the end user side or customer side, then we have to take the a harmonic current injected into the system by the inducer. And there are standards which are limited by or proposed by IEEE, and it is the standard 6519-1992. And according to that standard, how we have to see whether we have to see the limit of the current or limit of the voltage. So we have a process or evaluation procedure for determining the voltage limit on the utility side, and we have an evaluation process for determining the current limit on the inducer side. So by doing that process, we will know whether the limits are exceeded or limits are within the range. If the limits are within the range, it is fine. If it is exceeding the limit, then we have to go for some mitigation technique. So when we talk of mitigation techniques, we will have to see what are the basic principle of controlling the harmonic, and then what are the different devices used for controlling the harmonic, and how we can actually design this harmonic device, I mean mitigation devices. All these we have to see. So in this unit, we are going to see all. So I think we can stop for today, and next class we will start with the principles of controlling the harmonics. What are the general principles and what are the main devices which we use for controlling the harmonics? So that we will see in the next lecture. Thank you.